Four happy days bring in another moon. Oh, methinks how slow this old moon wanes. She lingers my desires like a stepdame or a dowager, long withering out a young man's revenue.
4 days will quickly seek themselves in the night. 4 nights will quickly dream away the time. And then the moon, like to a silver bow, new bit in heaven, shall behold the night of our solemnities.
Go, Philostrate. Stir up the Athenian youth to merriments. Mm-hmm. Awake the perk and nimble spirit of mirth.
Got it.
Turn melancholy forth to funerals. The pale companion is not for our pomp. Hippolyta, I wooed thee with my sword, and won thy love doing thee injuries, but I will wed thee in another key, with pomp, with triumph, and with revelry.
Happy be Theseus, our renowned duke!
Thanks, good Aegeus. What's the news with thee?
Full of vexation come I with complaint against my child, my daughter. Hermia, stand forth, Demetrius. My noble lord, this man hath my consent to marry her. Stand forth, Lysander, and my gracious duke. This man hath bewitched the bosom of my child. Thou, Lysander, thou hast given her rhymes and interchanged love tokens with my child. Thou hast by moonlight at her window sung with feigning voice verses of feigning love. Thou hast stolen the impression of her fantasy with bracelets of thy hair, rings, gauds, conceits, knacks, trifles, nosegays, sweetmeats, messengers of strong prevailment in unhardened youth. With cunning hast thou filched my daughter's heart and turned her obedience, which is due to me, to stubborn harshness. And my gracious duke, be it so she will not hear before your grace, consent to marry with Demetrius. I beg the ancient privilege of Athens. As she is mine, I may dispose of her, which shall be either to this gentleman or to her death, immediately provided in that case.
What say you, Hermia? The advice, fair maid, to you your father should be as a god, will not compose your beauties, yea, and one to whom you are, but as a form in wax, by him imprinted and within his power, to leave the figure or disfigure it. Demetrius is a worthy gentleman.
So is Lysander.
In himself he is. But in this kind, wanting your father's voice, the other must be held the worthier.
I would. My father looked but with my eyes.
Rather, your eyes must with his judgment look.
I do entreat your grace to pardon me. But I beseech your grace that I may know the worst that may befall me in this case if I refuse to wed Demetrius.
Either to die the death, or to abjure forever the society of men. Therefore, fair Hermia, question your desires. Know of your youth, examine well your blood, whether, if you yield not to your father's choice, you can endure the livery of a nun, for I to be in shady cloister mewed, to live a barren sister all your life, chanting faint hymns to the cold, fruitless moon.
So will I grow, so live, so die, my lord, ere I will yield my virgin patent up unto his lordship, whose unwished yoke my soul consents not to give sovereignty.
Take time to pause, and by the next new moon, that sealing day betwixt my love and me, for everlasting bond of fellowship. Upon that day, either prepare to die for disobedience to your father's will, or else to wed Demetrius, as he would. Or on Diana's altar to protest for high austerity and single life.
Relent, sweet Hermia!
And Lysander, yield thy crazy title to my certain rights!
You have her father's love, Demetrius. Let me have Hermia's. Do you marry him?
Oh, really?
Scornful Lysander! True, he hath my love, and what is mine my love shall render him, and she is mine, and all my right of her I do estate unto Demetrius. I am, my lord, as well derived as he, as well possessed. My love is more than his. My fortunes every way is fairly ranked, if not with vantage as Demetrius. And which is more than all these boasts can be, I am beloved of beauteous Hermia. Why should not I then prosecute my rights? Demetrius, I'll avouch it to his head, made love to Nader's daughter, Helena, and won her soul. She, sweet lady, dotes, devoutly dotes, dotes in idolatry upon this spotted and inconstant man.
I must confess I have heard so much, as Demetrius thought to have spoke thereof. But being over full of self-affairs, my mind did lose it. But Demetrius, come, and Aegeus, come. You'll go with me. I have some private schooling for you both. For you, fair Hermia, look you arm yourselves to fit your fancies to your father's will, else the law of Athens yields you up, if by no means you may extenuate, to death, to a vow of single life. Come, my Hippolyta. What cheer, my love? Demetrius and Aegeus go along. I must employ you in some business against our nuptial and confer with you something nearly that concerns yourself.
With duty and desire, we follow you.
How now, my love? Why is your cheek so pale? How chance the roses there do fade so fast?
The like for want of rain, which I could well beteem them from the tempest of my eyes.
Ay me, for aught that I could ever hear, could ever read in Taylor history. The course of true love never did run smooth, but either it was different in blood.
Oh, how to choose love by another's eyes!
Hear me, Hermia. I have a widow aunt, a dowager of great revenue. She hath no child. From Athens is her house a remote 7 leagues, and she respects me as her only son. Fair, gentle Hermia, may I marry thee. And to that place, the sharp Athenian law cannot pursue us. If thou lovest me, then, steal forth thy father's house tomorrow night, and in the wood a league without the town, where I did meet thee once to 2 observances to a morn of May with Helena. There will I stay for thee.
My good Lysander, I swear to thee by Cupid's strongest bow, by his best arrow with the golden head, by all the vows men have ever broke, in number more than women ever spoke. In the place thou hast appointed me, tomorrow truly will I meet with thee.
He promised, love. Look, here comes Helena.
Godspeed, fair Helena. Whither away?
Call you me fair? That fair again, I say. Demetrius loves your fair. Oh, happy fair. Your eyes are lodestars, your tongue sweet air. Oh, sickness is catching more favor so. Yours would I catch, fair Hermia. Here I go. My ear should catch your voice. My eye, your eye. My tongue should catch your tongue's sweet melody. Oh, were the world mine, Demetrius, being baited, the rest I'd give to be to you translated. Oh, teach me how you look, and with what art you sway the motion of Demetrius' heart.
I frown upon him, yet he loves me still.
Oh, that your frowns could teach my smiles such skill.
I give him curses, he gives me love.
Oh, that my prayers could such affection move.
The more I hate, the more he follows me.
The more I love, the more he hateth me.
His folly, Helena, is no fault of mine.
None, but your beauty, wish that fault were mine.
Take comfort, he no more shall see my face. My Lysander and myself shall fly this place.
Helen, to you our minds we will unfold. Tomorrow night, when Phoebe doth behold her silver visage in the watery glass, decking with liquid pearl the bladed grass, at a time when lovers' flights doth still conceal, through Athens' gates have we devised to steal.
And into the wood, for often you and I upon faint primrose beds were wont to lie, emptying our bosoms of their counsel sweet. There, my Lysander and myself shall meet. and thence from Athens turn away our eyes to seek new friends and stranger companies.
Hermia!
Farewell, sweet playfellow. Pray thou for us, and good luck grant thee thy Demetrius. Keep word, Lysander. We must starve our sight from lover's food till morrow, deep midnight.
I will, my Hermia.
Oh.
Helena, adieu. As you on him, Demetrius dote on you.
How happy some or other some can be. Through Athens I am thought as fair as she. But what of that? Demetrius thinks not so. He will not know what all but he do know. And as he errs doting on Hermia's eyes, so I, admiring of his qualities. Things base and vile, holding no quantity, love can transpose to form and dignity. Love looks not with the eyes, but with the mind, and therefore is winged Cupid painted blind. Nor hath love's mind any judgment taste, wings in no eyes figure unheedy haste. And therefore is love said to be a child, because in choice he is so oft beguiled. I will go tell him of fair Hermia's flight. Then to the wood will he tomorrow night pursue her. And for this intelligence, if I have thanks, it is a dear expense. But herein mean I, to enrich my pain, to have his sight thither and back again.
Oh. Is all our company here?
You're best called them generally, man by man, according to the script.
Here is the scroll of every man's name, which is thought fit through all Athens to play our interlude before the Duke and the Duchess on his wedding day at night.
First, good Peter Quint, say what the play treats on, and then read the names of the actors, and so grow to a point.
Marriage. Our play is the most lamentable comedy and most cruel death of Pyramus and Thisbe.
A very good piece of work, I assure you, and a happy one. Now, good Peter Quince, call forth your actors by the scroll. Masters, spread yourselves.
Answer as I call you. Nick Bottom the Weaver.
Ready. Name what part I inform. Proceed.
You, Nick Bottom, are set down for Pyramus.
Yes! What is Pyramus? A lover, a tyrant.
A lover. Oh. That kills himself most gallant for love.
Oh, that will ask some tears in the true performing art. If I do it, let the audience look to their eyes. I will move storms. I will condole in some measure. To the rest.
Francis.
Yet my chief humor is for a tyrant. I could play Hercules rarely, or some part to tear a cannon, to make Gaul split. The raging rocks and shivering shocks shall break the locks of prison gates. And Phoebus Carr shall shine from far and make and mar the foolish fates. Oh, this was lofty. Now, name the rest of the players.
Francis?
This is Hercules' vein, a tyrant's vein. A lover is more condolent.
Francis Flute, the bellows mender.
Jupiter Quince.
Flute, you must take Thisbe on you.
What is Thisbe? A wandering knight?
It is the lady that Pyramus must love.
Nay, Faith, let me not play a woman. I have a beard coming.
That's all one. You may play it in a mask, and you may speak as small as you will.
And I may hide my face. Let me play Thisbe too. I'll speak in a monstrous little voice. Thisbe! Thisbe! Oh, Pyramus, thy lady dear, lover dear, thy Thisbe dear!
No! No! You must wait Pyramus and Flute, you Thisbe.
Well, proceed.
Robin Starling the tailor.
Here, Peter Quince.
Starling, you must play Thisbe's mother. Tom Snout the tinker.
Here, Peter Quince.
You, Pyramus' father. Myself, Thisbe's father. Snug the joiner. You, the lion's part. And I hope here is a play fitted.
Have you the lion's part written? Pray you, if it be, give it to me, for I am slow of study.
You may do it extempore, for it is nothing but roaring.
Let me play the lion too.
Roar,
that I will do any man's heart to hear me. I will roar that I will make the Duke say, let him roar again! Let him roar again!
And you would do it too terribly, you would frighten the Duchess and the ladies, that they would shriek, and that'd be enough to hang us all.
That would hang us every mother's son.
I grant you, friends, that you should fright the ladies out of their wits. They would have no discretion but to hang us. But I will aggravate my voice, and I will roar you as gently as any sucking dove. I will roar you at a touring nightingale. Rah. Rah.
Rah! Oh, you are the pyramids!
In a summer's day, a most lovely, gentleman-like man. Therefore, you must needs play Pyramus.
David, it's your destiny.
Such a big time. Well, I will undertake it.
Master, here are your parts. I am to entreat you, request you, and desire you to come in by tomorrow night. Meet me in the palace wood, a mile without the town. By moonlight, there will we rehearse. I pray you, fail me not.
We will meet, and there we may rehearse most obscenely and courageously. Take pains, be perfect. Adieu!
On the green. I must go seek some dewdrops here and hang a pearl on every cowslip's ear. Farewell, thou lob of spirits. I'll be gone. Our queen and other elves come here anon.
The king doth keep his revels here tonight. Take heed the queen come not within his sight, for Oberon is passing fell in wrath, because that she, as her attendant, hath a lovely boy stolen from an Indian king. She never had so sweet a changeling, and jealous Oberon would have the child, knight of his train, to trace the forest wild. But she by force withholds the loved boy, crowns him with flowers, and makes him all her joy. And now they never meet in grove or green, by falcon clear or spangled starlight cheek. But they do square, that all their elf for fear, creep and acorn cups and hide them there.
Either I mistake your shape and making quite, or else you are that shrewd and knavish sprite called
Robin Goodfellow. Are not you he that frights the maidens of the villagery, skim milk and sometimes labor in the corn, and bootless makes the breathless housewife churn, and sometime make the drink to bear no barn, mislead night wanderers laughing at their harm. Those that hobgoblin call you, and sweet puck, you do their work and they shall have good luck. Are not you he?
Thou speakest aright.
I am that merry wonder of the night. I jest to Oberon and make him smile, when I affect and bean but horse beguile, neighing in the likeness of a filly foal. And sometime lurk I in a gossip's bowl, in the very likeness of a roasted crab. And when she drinks, against her lips I bob, and on her wither do that pour the ale. The wisest aunt telling the saddest tale. Sometime a 3-foot stool mistaketh me. Then slip I from her bum and down topple she, and Taylor cries and falls into a cup, and the whole choir hold their hips and laugh and wax in their mirth and knees and swear. A merrier hour was never wasted there. But room, fairy, here comes Oberon.
And here my mistress would that he were gone.
Ill met by moonlight, proud Natalia.
What, jealous Oberon? Fairy, skip hence. I have forsworn his better company.
Carrot! Rash one! Am not I thy lord?
Then I must be thy lady. But I know when thou hast stolen away from fairyland. Why art thou here, come from the farthest steppe of India, but that forsooth, the bouncing Amazon, your buskin mistress and your warrior love? To Theseus must be wedded, and you come to give their bed joy and prosperity.
How canst thou thus for shame, Titania? Glance at my credit with Hippolyta.
knowing I know thy love, Theseus.
Oh!
These are the bones of the bells. And never, since middle summer spring, met me on a hill and dale, forest or mead, by paved fountain or rushing brook, or in the beached margent of the sea, to dance our ringlets to the whistling wind. But with thy brawls thou hast disturbed our sport. Therefore the wind, piping to us in vain as in revenge, hath sucked up from the sea contagious fogs, which falling in the land hath every pelting river made so proud that they have overborne their continents. And this same progeny of evils comes from our debate, from our dissension. We are their parents and original.
Do you amend it then? It lies in you. Why should Titania cross her over? I do but beg a little changeling boy to be my henchman.
Set your heart at rest. The fairyland buys not the child of me. His mother was a votress of my order, and in the spice of Indian air by night, full often hath she gossiped by my side, and sat with me on Neptune's yellow sands, marking the embarking traders on the flood. When we have laughed to see sails conceive and grow big bellied with the wanton wind, which she, with pretty and with swimming gait following, her womb then rich with my own squire, would imitate, and sail upon the land to fetch me trifles and return again, as from a voyage rich with merchandise. But she, being mortal, that boy did die. And for her sake do I rear up her boy. And for her sake I will not part with him.
How long within this wood intend you stay?
Perchance till after Theseus' wedding day. If you will patiently dance in our round and see our moonlight revels, go with us. If not, shun me and I will spare your haunts.
Give me that boy and I will go with thee.
Not for thy fairy kingdom. Fairies, away. We shall chide downright if I longer stay.
Well, go thy way. Thou shalt not from this grove till I torment thee for this injury. My gentle partner, come hither. Thou rememberest, since once I sat upon a promontory and heard a mermaid on a dolphin's back, uttering such dulcet and harmonious breath that the rude sea grew civil at her song, and certain stars shot madly from their spheres to hear the sea maid's music.
I remember.
That very time I saw, when thou couldst not, flying between the cold moon and the earth, Cupid, all armed, a certain aim he took at a fair vestal throned by the west, and loosed his love shaft smartly as it should pierce 100,000 hearts. Yet marked I where the bolt of Cupid fell. It fell upon a little western flower, before milk white, now purple with love's wound, and maidens call it love in idleness.
Love in idleness?
Fetch me that flower. Here my trophy was. The juice of it on sleeping eyelids they will make man or woman madly dote upon the next live creature that it sees. Fetch me this herb, and be thou here again, ere the Leviathan can swim a lead.
I'll put a girdle around the earth in 40 minutes.
Having once this juice, I watch Titania when she is asleep, and drop the liquor of it in her eyes. The next thing then she waking looks upon, be it on lion or bear or wolf or bull, on meddling monkey or on busy ape, she shall pursue it with the soul of love. And ere I take this charm from off her sight, as I can take it with another herb, I'll make her render up her page to me. But who comes here? I am invisible and will overhear their conference.
Demetrius, wait!
I love thee not, therefore pursue me not. Where is Lysander and fair Hermia? The one I'll slay, the other slayeth me. Thou toldst me they were stolen into this wood. And here am I, and mad within this wood, because I cannot meet my Hermia. Hence, get thee gone and follow me no more.
You drum, you hard-hearted animal! But yet, you draw not iron, for my heart is true as steel. Leave you your power to draw, and I shall have no power to follow you.
Do I entice you?
Uh-huh.
Do I speak you fair? Or do I not, in plainest truth, tell you I do not, nor I cannot love you?
And even for that do I love you the more! I am your spaniel.
And Demetrius, the more you beat me, I will fawn on you, use me, but as your spaniel, spurn me, strike me, neglect me, lose me. Only give me leave, unworthy as I am, to follow you. What worser place can I beg in your love, and yet a place of high respect with me, than to be used as you use your dog?
Tempt not too much the hatred of my spirit, for I am sick when I look on thee.
And I am sick when I look not on you.
You do impede your modesty too much. To leave the city and commit yourself into the hands of one that loves you not, to trust the opportunity of night in the ill counsel of a desert place with the rich worth of your virginity.
Your virtue is my privilege. For that, it is not the night when I do see your face. Therefore, I think I am not in the night, nor doth this wood lack worlds of company, for you in my respect are all the world. Then how can it be said I am alone, when all the world is here to look on me?
Hold on for me, hide me in the brakes, and leave thee to the mercy of wild beasts.
The wildest hath not such a heart as you. Run when you will, the story shall be changed. Apollo flies and Daphne holds the chase. The dove pursues the griffin. The mild hind makes speed to catch the tiger. Bootless speed, when cowardice pursues and valor flies.
I will not stay thy questions. Let me go. Or, if thou follow me, do not believe that I shall do thee mischief in the wood.
I am the temple, the town, the field. You do me mischief. Fly, Demetrius. Your wrongs do set a scandal on my sex. We cannot fight for love as men may do. We should be wooed, and we're not made to woo. I'll follow thee and make a heaven of hell to die upon the hands I love so well.
Fare thee well, Nick. Ere he do leave this grove, thou shalt fly him, and he shall seek thy love. Hast thou the flower there? Welcome, Wanderer.
Ah, there it is.
I pray thee give it me. I know a bank where the wild thyme blows, where oxlips and the nodding violet grows, quite or canopied with luscious woodbine, with sweet musk roses and with eglantine. There sleeps Titania, sometime of the night, lulled in these flowers with dances and delight. And there the snake throws her enameled skin, weed wide enough to wrap a fairy in. And with the juice of this, I'll streak her eyes and make her full of hateful fantasies. Take out some of this. Seek through this robe. A sweet Athenian lady is in love with a disdainful youth. Anoint his eyes, but do it when the next thing he espies may be the lady. Thou shalt know the man by the Athenian garments he hath on. Effect it with some care, that he may prove more fond on her than she upon her love. And look thou meet me here ere the first cock crow.
Fear not, my lord, your servant shall do so.
When thou dost wake, do it for thy true love's take. Love and languish for his sake. Be it lynx or cat or bear, pard or boar with bristled hair. In thy eye that shall appear, when thou wakest, it is thy dear. Wake when some vile thing is near.
Fair love, you faint with wandering in the wood, and to speak truth, I have forgot our way. We'll rest us, Hermia, if you think it good, and tarry for the comfort of the day.
Be it so, Lysander, find you out of bed, for I upon this bank will rest my head.
One turf shall serve as pillow for us both. One heart, one bed, two bosoms in one troth.
Nay, good Lysander, for my sake, my dear, lie further off. Do not lie so near.
Oh, take the sense, sweet, of my innocence. Love takes the meaning in love's conference. I mean, my heart unto yours is knit, so that but one heart we can make of it. Two bosoms interchained with an oath, so then two bosoms and a single troth. So by your side, no better be denied. For lying so, Hermia, I do not lie.
Lysander riddles very prettily. Now, much beshrew my manners and my pride if Hermia meant to say Lysander lied. But gentle friend, for love and courtesy, lie further off. In human modesty, such separation as may well beset becomes a virtuous bachelor and a maid. So far be distant. And good night, sweet friend. Let thy love ne'er alter till thy sweet life end.
Amen. Amen to that fair prayer, say I. And then end life when I end loyalty. Here is my bed. Sleep grant thee all his rest.
And with half that wish, the wisher's eyes be pressed.
Through the forest have I gone, but Athenian found I on his eyes, I might prove this flower's force and stirring love.
Night and silence. Who is here?
Read the Athenians where this is he, my master said. Despise the Athenian maid.
And here the maiden sleeping sound on the dank and dirty ground. Pretty soul, she durst not lie in this lack love, this killed courtesy. Girl, upon thy eyes I throw all the power this charm doth throw. When thou wakest, let love forbid, sleep his seat on thy eyelid. So awake when I'm gone, for I must now to Oberon.
Stay! Thou wilt kill me, sweet Demetrius.
I charge thee hence, and do not taunt me thus.
Wilt thou, darkling, leave me here? Do not so!
Stay, on thy peril, I alone will go.
Oh, I am out of breath in this fond chase. The more my prayer, the lesser is my grace. Happy is Hermia wheresoe'er she lies, for she hath blessed and attractive eyes. How came her eyes so bright, not with salt tears? If so, mine eyes are oftener more washed than hers. No, I am as ugly as a bear. For beasts that meet me run away with fear. Therefore no marvel though Demetrius do, as a monster fly my presence thus. What wicked and dissembling glass of mine made me compare with Hermia's fiery eye? But who is here? Lysander, on the ground, dead or asleep? I see no blood, no wounds. Lysander, if you live, good sir, awake.
And run through fire would I for thy sweet sake. Transparent Helena, nature shows art that through thy bosom makes me see thy heart. Where is Demetrius? Oh, how fit a word is that vile name to perish on my sword.
Do not say so, Lysander, say not so. What though he love your Hermia, Lord, what though? Yet Hermia still loves you, then be content.
Content with Hermia? No, I do repent the tedious minutes I with her have spent. Not Hermia, but Helena I love, for who would not change a raven for a dove? The will of man is by his reason swayed, and reason says you are the worthier maid. Things growing are not ripe until their season. So I, being young, till now ripe not to reason, and touching now the point of human skill, reason becomes the marshal to my will, and leads me to your eyes, where I overlook love stories written in love's richest book.
Where was I to this keen mockery born? When at your hand did I deserve this scorn? It's not enough, young man, that I did never know, nor never can, deserve a sweet look from Demetrius' eye. But you must mock my insufficiency. Good truth, you do me wrong, good sooth, you do, in such disdainful manner me to woo. But fare you well. Perforce, I must confess, I thought you lord of more true gentleness. Oh, that a lady of one man refused should of another therefore be abused.
She sees not Hermia. Hermia, sleep thou there, and never mayst thou come Lysander near. For as a surfeit of the sweetest things, the deepest loathing to the stomach brings. Or as the heresies that men do leave are hated most of those they did deceive. So thou, my surfeit and my heresy, of all be hated, but the most of me. And all my powers address your love and might to honor Helen and to be her knight. Helena!
Help me, Lysander, help me! Do thy best to bless this spell except it from my breast!
I me, for pity, what a dream was here. Oh, Lysander, look, I do quake with fear. Methought a serpent ate my heart away, and you sat smiling at his cruel prey. Lysander?
What? Removed?
Lysander! Lord! What, out of hearing gone? No sound, no word? Alack, where are you? Speak! Speak, and if you hear, speak of all loves. Oh, I swoon almost with fear. No? Then I well perceive you are not nigh. Either death or you I'll find immediately.
Are we all met?
Perhaps. And here's a marvelous convenient place for rehearsal. This reed plot shall be our stage. This Hawthorn Bridge shall be our tiring house. And we will do it in action, and we will do it before the Duke.
Peter Quince.
What sayest thou, little bottom?
There are things in this comedy of Pyramus and Thisbe that will never please. First, Pyramus must draw a sword and kill himself, which the ladies cannot abide. How answers thou that?
Who's a perilous fear? I believe we must leave the killing out when all is done.
Not a bit. I have a device to make all well. Write me a prologue, and let the prologue seem to say we will do no harm with our swords, and that Pyramus is not killed indeed. And, for the more better assurance, tell them that I, Pyramus, am not Pyramus, but Bottom the Weaver. This will put them out of fear.
Well, we'll have such a prologue.
Will not the ladies be afeard of the lion?
I promise you.
Masters, you ought to consider with yourselves to bring in, God shield us, a lion among ladies is a most dreadful thing. There is not a more fearful, wild, foul than your lion living. And we ought to look to it.
Therefore, another prologue must tell that he is not a lion.
Nay, you must name his name, and half his face must be seen through the lion's neck, and he himself must speak through saying thus, or to the same effect, ladies, or fair ladies, I would request you, or I would entreat you, or I would wish you not to fear, not to tremble, my life for yours. For if you think I come hither as a lion, it were a pity on my life. No! I am no such thing. I am a man as other men are. And there indeed, let him name his name. Tell them plainly, he is Snug the Joiner.
Snug the Joiner!
But there are two hard things. That is, to bring moonlight into a chamber, for you know, Pyramus and Thisbe meet by moonlight.
Doth the moon shine the night we play our play?
Calendar, A calendar! Look in the almanac! Find out moonshine! Find out moonshine!
Yes! Let's try that night!
Why then may we leave a casement at the great chamber window where we play open, and the moon may shine in the casement?
Aye! Or else one must come in with a bush of thorn and a lamp thorn and say he comes to disfigure or to present the person who will shine. Then there's another. There must be a wall in the great chamber, for Pyramus and Thisbe says the story did talk through the chink of a wall.
You can never bring in a wall. What say you, Bonnie?
Some man or other must present wall. And let him have some plaster or some loam or some rough cast about him to signify wall. And let him hold his fingers thus. Through that cranny shall Pyramus and Thisbe whisper.
Well, if that may be, then all is well. Come sit down every mother's son and rehearse your parts. Pyramus, you begin. When you've spoken your speech, enter into that break. And so everyone according to his cue.
What have been home fun to have me swaggering here? So near the cradle of the fairy queen.
What? A plague door?
Oh, be an auditor. An act or two, perhaps, if I see cause.
Speak, Pyramus. Thisbe, stand forth.
Thisbe, the flowers of odious savor sweet.
Odors.
Odors, savor sweet. So hath thy breast. Thy breath, my dearest Thisbe. Come, but hark, a voice! Stay thou but here a while, and by I will to thee appear.
A stranger, Pyramus, that ever played here.
Must I speak now?
Aye, Mary, must you, for we must understand he goes but to see a noisy herd and is to come again.
Most radiant Pyramus.
Most radiant,
most radiant Pyramus, most lily white of hue, of color like the red rose on triumphant briar, most brisky juvenile, most lovely juvenile, as true as horse, that yet would never tire, I'll meet thee, Pyramus, at Nanny's too.
Nine is two, man. Well, you must not speak that yet, and you answer to Pyramus. You speak all your parts at once, cues and all. Pyramus, enter! Your cue is past! It is never tire!
As true as horse, that yet would never tire!
If I were fair, Thisbe, I were only nine!
Oh, monstrous! Oh, strange! We are haunted! Free masters! Oh, poor masters! Ah!
Oh, follow me! I'll lead you about to round, through bog, through bush, through brake, through bar. Sometime a horse I'll be, sometime a a hog, a headless bear, a time of fire. Roar! And then one roar, but it burned, like horse hounds hog bear fight, and then we turn.
Why did they run?
This is a knavery to make me afeard.
Oh, Bottom, thou art changed. What do I see on thee?
What do you see? You see an asset of your own. You go, get gone.
Bless thee, Bottom. Bless thee. Thou art transformed.
I see their knavery.
This is to make an ass of me, to break me if they could. But I will not stir from this place, do what they will. I will walk up and down here, and I shall sing that they shall hear that I am not afraid.
The ouzel cock so black of hue, with orange and tawny bill, the throstle with his nose so true, the wren with little quill.
What angel wakes me from my flower bed?
The fish, the sparrow, and the lark, the plain so cuckoo gray, whose note for many a man doth mark that does not answer nay.
I pray thee, gentle mortal, sing again.
Nay!
Mine ear is much enamored of thy note, so is mine eye much enthralled to thy shape. Thy fair virtue's force perforce doth move me to say, to swear I love thee.
Methinks, mistress, thou hast little reason for that.
And yet, to say the truth, reason and love keep little company together nowadays. More the pity that some honest neighbor won't make them friends. Nay, I can joke upon occasion.
Thou art as wise as thou art beautiful.
Not so neither, but if I had enough wit to get out of this wood, I would have enough to serve mine own.
Out of this wood do not desire to go. Thou shalt remain here, whether thou wilt or no. I am a spirit of no common rate. The summer still doth tend upon my state, and I do love thee. Therefore, go with me. I'll give thee fairies to attend on thee, and they shall fetch thee jewels from the deep while thou on pressed flowers dost sleep. And I will purge thy mortal grossness so that thou shalt like an airy spirit go. Peas blossom, cobweb, mop, mustard seed.
Ready! And I!
And I!
And I!
And I!
Where shall we go?
Be kind and courteous to this gentleman. Hop in his walks and frolic in his eyes. Feed him with apricots and dewberries, purple grapes, green figs, and mulberries. The honey bags steal from the humble bees, and for night tapers crook their waxen thighs, and light them at the fiery glowworm's eyes. To have my love to bed and to arise, to pluck the wings from painted butterflies, to fan the moonbeams from his sleeping eyes, nod to him elves, and do him courtesies.
Hail, mortal!
Hail!
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 I cry your worship's mercy heartily. I beseech your worship's name.
Cobweb.
Good Master Cobweb, I shall desire you of more acquaintance. If I cut my finger, I shall make bold with you. Your name, honest man.
Please.
I pray you commend you to Mistress Swash, your mother, Master Peascod, your father. Good Master Peas Blossom, I shall desire you of more acquaintance too. Your name, I beseech you, madam.
Mustard seed.
Oh, mustard seed, I know your patience well. I promise you, kindred have made my eyes water ere now. Mm-hmm. Mustard seed, I shall desire your more acquaintance too.
Come, wait upon him. Lead him to my bower. The moonbeam thinks looks with a watery eye, and when she weeps, weeps every little flower, lamenting some enforced chastity.
What's your name?
Quiet, my love's tongue. Bring him silently. Him this advantage take. Onassis Noll, I fix it on his head. Anon, his thisbe must be answered, and forth my mimic comes, when they him spy, as some wild geese away his fellows fly. I led them on this distracted fear, and left sweet Pyramus translated there, when in that moment, so it came to pass, Titania waked and straightway loved an ass! This falls out better than I could devise. But hast thou yesterday slashed the Athenian's eyes with the love juice as I did bid thee do? I took him sleeping, that is finished too, and the Athenian woman by his side, that when he awaked, a force she must be I. Stand close. This is the same Athenian.
This is the woman, but not this man.
Oh, why rebuke you, him that loves you so? Lay breath so bitter on your bitter foe.
Now I would chide, but I should use thee worse. But thou, I fear, hast given me cause to curse. If thou hast slain my standard in sleeping, or she's in blood, plunge in the deep and kill me too. It cannot be, but thou hast murdered him. So should a murderer look, so dead, so grim.
So should the murdered look, and so should I. Pierced through the heart with your stern cruelty. Yet you, the murderer, look as bright, as clear as yonder Venus in her glimmering sphere.
What's this to my Lysander? Where is he? Oh, good Demetrius, wilt thou give him me?
I'd rather give his carcass to my hounds.
Out, dog!
Ow!
Out, cur!
Ah!
Thou drivest me past the mouth of meditation! Hast thou slain him then? Oh, henceforth be never numbered among men. Oh, once tell true even for my sake. Durst thou have looked upon him being awake? And has that killed him sleep? Ah! Brave touch! Could not a worm, an adder, do so much? An adder did it, for with doubler tongue than thine, thou serpent ever never stung.
You spend your passion on a misprized mood. I am not guilty of Lysander's blood, nor is he dead for aught that I can tell.
I pray thee then, tell me that he's well.
And if I could, what should I get there for?
A privilege never to see me more.
Oh!
And from thy hated presence part I so. See me no more, whether he be dead or no.
There is no following her in this fierce vein. Here, therefore, for a while I will remain. So sorrow's heaviness doth heavier grow, for debt that bankrupt sleep doth sorrow owe, which now in some slight measure it will pay, if for his tender here I make some stay.
What hast thou done? Thou hast mistaken quite, and laid the love juice on some true love's sight. Of thy misprison must perforce ensue some true love turned, and not a false turned true.
Then fate overrules that one man, holding troth, a million fail, confounding oath on oath.
About the wood, go, swifter than the wind, and Helena of Athens look thou fine. All fancy sick is she, and pale of cheer, with sighs of love that cost the fresh blood dear. By some illusion, see thou bring her here. I'll charm his eyes against you.
I go, look how I go, swifter than arrow from the starry bow.
Flower of this purple dye, hitch with Cupid's eye. Sink in apple of his eye. When his love he doth espy, let her shine as gloriously as the Venus of the sky. When thou wakest, if she be by, beg of her for remedy.
Captain of our fairy band, Helena is here at hand, and the youth mistook by me, pleading for a lover's fee. Shall we their fawn pageant see? Lord of fools, these mortals be.
Stand aside, the noise they make will cause Demetrius to awake.
Then we'll two at once for one. Thine must needs be sport alone, and those saints best do please me, though fall preposterously.
Why should you think that I should woo in scorn? Scorn and derision never come in tears. Look, when I vow I weep, and vows so born in their nativity, all truth appears. How could these things in me seem scorn to you, bearing the badge of faith to prove them true?
But you do advance your cunning more and more. When truth kills truth, oh, devilish holy fray, these vows are Hermia's. Will you give her or weigh oath with oath, and you will nothing weigh? Your vows to her and me, put in two scales, will even weigh, and both as light as tails.
I have no judgment when to her I swore.
Nor none in my mind, now you give her or.
Demetrius loves her, and he loves not you.
Oh, Helena. Goddess, nymph, perfect, divine. To what, my love, shall I compare thine eyne? Crystal is muddy. Oh, how ripened show thy lips, those kissing cherries tempting grow. Oh, that pure congealed white, high Taurus snow, fanned with the eastern wind, turns to a crow when thou hold'st up thy hand. Oh, let me kiss this princess of pure white, this seal of bliss.
Oh, spite. Oh, hell! I see you all are bent to set against me for your merriment. If you were civil and knew courtesy, you would not do me thus much injury. Can you not hate me as I know you do?
No.
But you must join in souls to mock me too. If you were men as men you are in show, you would not use a gentle lady so.
swear and super praise thy parts when I am sure you hate me with your hearts. You both are rivals in love, Hermia, and now both rivals to mock Helena. A fine exploit, a manly enterprise, to conjure up tears in a poor maid's eyes. But yours are broken! None of noble sort would so offend a virgin and extort a poor soul's patience, all to make you sport.
You are unkind, Demetrius. Be not so, for you love Hermia. This you know I know. So here, with all goodwill, with all my heart, in Hermia's love I yield you up my part. And yours of Helena to me bequeath, whom I do love and will do till my death.
Never did mockers waste more idle breath.
Why, Sander, keep thy Hermia. I will none. If e'er I loved her, all that love is gone. My heart to her but is guestwise sojourned, and now to Helen it is home returned, there to remain.
Helen, it is not so!
Despair is not the faith thou dost not know, lest to thy peril thou will buy it dear. Look where thy love comes, yonder is thy dear.
Dark night, perhaps if the eye whose function takes the ear more quick of apprehension makes, when doubly pairs the same sense, it pays the hearing double recompense. Thou art not by mine eye, Lysander, found mine ear. I think it brought me to thy sound. But why unkindly didst thou leave me so?
Why should he stay, whom love doth press to go?
What love could press Lysander from my side?
Lysander's love, which would not let him bide. Fair Helena, who more in guilt the night than all you fiery O's and eyes of light. Why seekest thou me? Could not this make thee know? That the hate I bear thee may believe thee so?
You speak not as you think it cannot be.
Lo, she is one of this confederacy! Now I perceive they have conjoined all three to fashion this false sport in spite of me. Injurious Hermia, most ungrateful maid! Have you conspired? Have you with these contrived to bait me in this foul derision? Is all the counsel we two have shared, the sisters' vows, the hours we have spent when we chid the hasty footed time for parting us? Oh, is it all forgot? All school days, friendships, childhood innocence? And will you rent our ancient love asunder to join with men? In scorning your poor friend? It is not friendly, 'tis not maidenly. Our sex, as well as I, may charge you for it, though I alone do feel the injury.
I am amazed at your passionate words. I scorn you not. It seems that you scorn me.
Have you not said Lysander, as in scorn, to praise my eyes and face, and made your other love, Demetrius, who even but now did spurn me with his foot, to call me goddess, nymph, divine and rare, precious, celestial, stop! Wherefore speaks he this to her he hates? And wherefore doth Lysander deny your love, so rich within his soul and tender me, versus affection, but by your setting on, by your consent? What though I be not so in grace as you, so hung upon with love, so fortunate, but miserable most to love unloved? This you should pity rather than despise.
I understand not what you mean by this.
Hi, do persever, counterfeit sad looks, make mouths upon me when I turn my back. Wink at each other, hold this sweet jest up. This sport, well carried, shall be chronicled. If you have any pity, grace, or manners, you would not make me such an argument. But fare ye well, 'tis partly my own fault, which death or absence soon shall remedy.
Stay, gentle Helena, hear my excuse, my love, my life, my soul, fair Helena.
Oh, excellent!
Sweet, do not scorn her so.
If she cannot entreat, I can compel. Thou canst compel no more than she entreat. Thy threats have no more strength than her weak prayers. Helen, I love thee. By my life I do. I swear by that which I will lose for thee, to prove him false that says I love thee not.
I say I love thee more than he can do.
If thou say so, withdraw and prove it too.
Quick, come.
All this.
What are you, idiot?
No, no. He'll seem to break loose. Take on as you would follow, but yet come not. You are a tame man.
Yo! Hang off, thou cat, thou bird! Wild thing let loose, or I'll shake you from me like a serpent!
Why are you grown so rude? What changes this sweet love?
Thy love! Out, tawny tartar! Out! Out, loathed medicine! Hated potion! Hence!
Do you not jest?
Yes, truth, and so do you!
Demetrius, I will keep my word with thee.
I would I had your bond. For I perceive a weak bond holds you. I'll not trust your word.
What? Should I hurt her? Strike her? Kill her dead? Although I hate her, I'll not harm her so.
What greater harm can you do me than hate? Hate me? Wherefore, oh me? What news, my love? Am not I Hermia? Are not you Lysander? I'm as fair now as I was erewhile. Since night you loved me, yet since night you left me. Why? Then you left me, oh, the gods forbid, in earnest, shall I say?
Aye, by my life, and never didst desire to see thee more. So therefore be out of hope, of love, of question. Be certain, nothing truer, 'tis no jest that I do hate thee. And love Helena.
Stop! Not what to say.
Still thou mistakest, else commits thy knaveries willfully.
Believe me, King of Shadows, I mistook. Did not you tell me I should know the man by the Athenian garments he had on? And thus, blameless proves my enterprise that I have anointed an Athenian's eyes. And so far, I'm glad it did so sort, as this their jangling I esteem a sport.
Thou seest these lovers seek a place to fight. I therefore, Robin, overcast the night, and lead these testy rivals so astray as one come not within another's way. Like to Lysander, sometime frame thy tongue, then stir Demetrius up with bitter wrong, and sometime rail thou like Demetrius, and from each other look thou lead them thus, till o'er their brows death counterfeiting sleep, with leaden legs and batty wings doth creep. Then crush this ode into Lysander's eye. Lysander, whose liquor hath this virtuous property, to take from thence all error with his might, and make his eyeballs roll with normal sight. When they next wake, all this derision shall seem a dream and fruitless vision. And then to Athens shall the lovers wend, with league whose date till death shall never end. Whiles I in this affair do thee employ, I'll to my queen and beg her Indian boy. And then I will her charmed eye release from monster's view, and all things shall be peace.
Up and down, up and down, I will lead them up and down. I am feared and field and town, God will lead them up and down. Here comes one.
Where art thou, proud Demetrius? Speak thou now.
Here, villain, drawn and ready.
What?
Where art thou?
I will be with thee straight.
Follow me then, plainer ground.
Lysander, speak again. Thou run away, thou coward, art thou fled? Speak, in some bush, where dost thou hide thy head?
Thou coward, art thou bragging to the stars, telling the bushes they look us for wars and wilt not come? Come, coward, come thou, child, I'll whip thee with a rod.
Ah!
He is defiled to draw the sword on thee.
Yea, art thou there?
Follow me, we'll try no banquet here.
He goes before me, still he dares me on. When I come where he calls, then he is gone. The villain is much lighter heeled than I. I followed fast, but faster he did fly. And fallen am I in dark and even way. Here will rest me. Come, thou gentle day, for if but once thou show me thy gray light, I'll find Demetrius and revenge this spite.
Me, coward, why comest thou not?
Abide me, if thou darest, for well I wot, thou runst before me, shifting every place, and darest not stand nor look me in the face. Where art thou now?
Come hither.
I am here.
Nay, then thou mockest me. Thou shalt buy this dear if ever I thy face by daylight see. Go thy way. Faintness constraineth me. Measure out my length on this cold bed, and by day's approach look to be visited.
O weary night, O long and tedious night, abate thy hour. Shine comforts from the east so that I may back to Athens by daylight from these that my poor company detest. And sleep that sometimes shuts up sorrow's eye, steal me a while from mine own company.
Yet but three, come one more. Two of both kind make up four. Here she comes, cursed and sad. You've been a knavish lad, thus to make poor female mad.
Never so weary, never so in woe, bedeviled by dew and torn with briars. Oh, no further can I crawl, no further go. My legs can keep no pace with my desires. And here will I rest me till the break of day. Here will I rest me till the break of day. Oh, heavens shield Lysander if they mean a fray.
On the ground, sleep sound. I'll apply to your eye, gentle lover, remedy. When thou wakest, thou takest true delight in the sight of thy former lady's eye. And the country proverb known, in your waking shall be shown, Jack shall have Jill, not shall be ill, the man shall have his Marigan, and all shall be well. Well, I, thy amiable cheeks do coy, and stick much roses in thy sleek, smooth head, and kiss thy fair heart, my gentle joy.
Where's Peas Blossom?
Ready!
Scratch my head, Peas Blossom. Where's Cobb?
Ready!
Monsieur Cobb, good monsieur. Get your weapons in hand and kill me a red-hip tumblebee on top of this one. Oh, and good monsieur, bring me the honey bag. Do not fret yourself too much in the action, good monsieur. Oh! And have care the honey bag break not. I would be loath to have you overflown with a honey bag. Where's mustard seed?
Ready.
Lend me your hand.
What's your book?
Nothing, good monsieur, but to help Calvary Cobweb to scratch. I must have the barbers, for methinks I'm marvelous hairy about the face. And if my hair do but tickle me, I must scratch.
What? Wilt thou hear some music, sweet love?
Oh, I have a reason for video music. Let's have the tongs and the bones.
Or say, sweet love, what thou desirest to eat.
Methinks I desire a bottle of hay. Good hay, sweet hay hath no fellow.
I have a venturous fairy that shall seek the squirrel's hoard and fetch thee new nuts.
I had rather a handful or two of dried peas. But I pray you, let none of your people stir. I have an exposition. Sleep, come upon.
Sleep back, and I will wind to you my arm. Fairies, be gone. Be always away. So doth the woodbine the sweet honeysuckle gently entwist, the female ivy so enrings the barky fingers of the elm. How I love thee, how I dote on thee.
Welcome, good Robin. Seest thou this sweet sight? Her dotage now I do begin to pity. For meeting her late behind the wood, seeking sweet favors from this hateful fool, I did upbraid her and fall out with her, for she his parried temples then had ground with the corn and the fresh and fragrant flowers. When I had, at my pleasure, taunted her, and she in mild terms begged my patience, I then did ask of her her changeling child, which straight she gave me, and her fairy said to bear him to my bower in fairy land. And now I have the boy. I will undo this hateful imperfection of her eyes. And, gentlefolk, take this transformed scalp from off the head of this Athenian swain, that he, awaking when the other do, may all to Athens back again repair, and think no more of this night's accident but of the fierce vexation of a dream. But first I will release the fairy queen. Be as thou wast wont to be, see as thou wast wont to see, Dian's bud or Cupid's flower hath such force and blessed power. Now, my Titania, wake you, my sweet queen.
Why, Oberon, what visions have I seen? We thought I was enamored of an ass.
There lies your
mind. Oh, how mine eyes do loathe his visage now.
Silence a while. Robin, take off his head. Music call, and strike more dead than common sleep of all these five senses.
Music ho, music such charm as sleep.
Now, when thou wakest with thy own fool's eyes, beep! Sound music! Come, my tit-tat, and rock the ground whereon these sleep. Now thou and I are new enamored, and will, tomorrow midnight, solemnly, dance in Duke Theseus' house triumphant.
and blessed to all fair prosperity.
There shall the pairs of faithful lovers be, wedded with Theseus, all in jollity.
Fair king, attend and mark, I do hear the morning lark.
Then, my queen, in silence sad, trip we after the night's shade. We the globe can compass soon, swifter than the wandering moon.
Come, my lord, and in our flight, tell me how it came this night that I, sleeping here, was found with these mortals on the ground.
Go, woman, find the forceps, for now our observation is performed. But soft, what nymphs are these?
My lord, this is my daughter here asleep. This Lysander is, this Demetrius, and this Helena, old Nadar's Helena. I wonder if they're being here together.
No doubt they rose up early to observe the rites of May, and hearing our intents came to grace in our solemnity. Speak, Aegeus. This is not the day that Hermia should give answer of her choice.
It is, my lord.
Go, bid the huntsmen, wake them with their horns. Horns! Good morrow, friends. St. Valentine is past. Begin these woodbirds but to couple now?
Pardon, my lord.
I pray you all, stand up. No, you two are rival enemies. How comes this gentle concord in the world? That hatred is so far from jealousy. To sleep by hate and fear no enmity?
My lord, I shall reply amazedly. Half sleep, half waking, but as yet, I swear I cannot truly say how I came here. But as I think, for surely I would speak, and now do I bethink me. So it is, I came with Hermia hither. Our intent was to be gone from Athens, where we might, without the peril of the Athenian law.
Enough! Enough, my lord, you have enough. I beg the law upon his head. They would have stolen away, they would, to have defeated you and me, Demetrius. You of your wife and me of my consent. Of my consent that she should be your wife.
My lord, fair Helen told me of their stealth, of this their purpose, hither to this wood. And I in fury hither followed them. Fair Helen in fancy following me. But my good lord, I know not by what power. By some power it is, my love to Hermia melted as the snow. It seems to me now that, as in the remembrance of an idle toy, which in my childhood I did dote upon, and all the faith, the virtue of my heart, the object and the pleasure of mine eye, is only Helena. To her, my lord, was I betrothed ere I saw Hermia, but like in sickness did I loathe this food, that as in health come to my natural taste. Now I do wish it, love it, long for it, and will forevermore be true to it.
Fair lovers, you are fortunately met. Of this discourse we more will hear anon. Aegeus, I will overbear your will. For in the temple, by and by with us, these couples shall eternally be knit. And for the morning now is something worn, our proposed hunting shall be set aside. Away with us to Athens, three and three. We'll hold a feast in great solemnity.
Things seem small and undistinguishable.
Methinks I see these things with a parted eye, when everything seems double.
So methinks, and I have found Demetrius like a jewel, mine own and not mine own.
Are you sure that we are awake? It seems to me that yet we sleep, we dream. Now you think the Duke was here and bid us follow him?
Aye, and my father.
And Hippolyta.
And he bid us follow to the temple.
Why, then we are awake. Let us follow him, and by the way, let us recount our dreams.
When my cue comes, call me and I shall enter. My next is most fair Pyramus.
Hey! Ho! Peter Quince! Blue! Helmsman there! Stop the tinker! Oh! Gods, my life, stolen hence, and left me asleep. I have had a most rare vision. I've had a dream past the wit of man to say what dream it was. Man is but an ass if he were to go about to expound upon this truth. Methought I was. There's no man can tell what. Methought I was, and methought I had. But man is but a patch fool if he will offer to say what methought I had. The eye of man hath not heard. The ear of man hath not seen. Man's hand is not able to taste. His tongue to conceive, nor his heart to report what my dream was. I'll get Peter Quince to write a ballad of this dream, and it shall be called Bottom's Dream, for it hath no bottom. And I shall sing it at the latter end of the play before the Duke. Peradventure, to make it the more gracious, I shall sing it at Thisbe's death.
House? Is he come home yet?
He cannot be heard of. Out of doubt he is transported.
If he comes not, the play is marred. It goes not forward, doth it?
It is not possible. You have not a man in all Athens able to discharge Pyramus but he.
Nay, you have simply the best wit any handicraft man in Athens.
Yea, and the best person too. He is a very paramour for sweet voice.
You must say paragon. A paramour is, God bless us, a thing of naught.
Masters! The Duke is coming from the temple. There are two or three lords and ladies more married. The first port had gone forward, we'd have all been made men.
Oh, sweet Bully Bottom!
Where are these lads? Where are these hogs?
Oh, it's almost happy hour!
Masters!
I have wonders to discourse, but ask me not what, for if I tell you, I am no true Athenian. I'll tell you everything, right at the bell.
Let us hear, sweet bottom.
Not a word of it. All that I will say is that the Duke hath dined. Get your apparel together, good strings to your beards, good ribbons to your pumps. Every man look over his part and meet presently at the palace, for the short and the long of it is, our play is preferred.
Yes!
In any case, let he that plays Thisbe have clean linens. And let not he that plays the lion pare his nails, for they shall hang out for the lion's claws. And, most dear actors, eat no onions nor garlic, for we are to utter sweet breath, and I do not doubt but to hear them say, it's a sweet comedy. Shh, no more words, away, go away!
Bottom, 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 bottom!
Shall we have to wear away this long age of 3 hours between our after supper and bedtime? Where is our usual manager of mirth? What revels are in hand? Is there no play to ease the anguish of a torturing hour? Call Philostrate.
Here, my Theseus.
Say, what a bridge is this evening? What mass, what music? How shall we beguile the lazy time if not with some delight?
There are a brief number of how many sports are ripe. Make your decision of which your highness shall see first.
The battle with the centaurs, to be sung by an Athenian eunuch to the harp. Well, none of that. That I am told my love in glory of my kinsman Hercules. The rite of the tipsy bacchanals, tearing the Thracian singer in their rage.
Definitely not.
That is an old device, and it was played when I from Thebes came last to conquer. A tedious brief scene of young Pyramus and his lover Thisbe. Very tragical mirth. Merry and tragical? Tedious and brief? That is hot ice and wondrous strange snow. How shall we find the concord to this discord?
A play there is, my lord, some 10 words long, which is as brief as I have known a play. My lord, by ten words, my lord, it is too long, which makes it tedious. For in all the play, there is not one word apt, one player fitted. And tragical it is, my lord, for Pyramus then doth kill himself, which, when I saw rehearsed, I must confess, made mine eyes water, but more merry tears than that loud laughter never shed.
What are they that do play?
Hard-headed men that work in Athens here, that never labored in their minds till now.
And we will hear.
No, my noble lord. I've heard it over. It is nothing. Nothing at all. Unless you can find sport in their intent. Extremely stretched and extremely cruel pain to do your service.
I will hear that play. For never anything can be amiss when simpleness and duty tender. Go, bring the mace. And take your place, ladies.
No, I love not to see wretchedness charge, and duty and service perish.
Oh, my gentle sweet, you see no such thing.
But he says they can do nothing of the kind.
The kind are we to give them thanks for nothing. Our sport will be to take what they mistake. And what poor duty cannot do, no respect takes it in might, not merit.
So please your grace, the prologue is addressed.
Let him approach.
Gentles, perchance you wonder at the show, but wonder on till truth make all things plain. This man is Pyramus, if you would know. This beauteous lady Thisbe is certain. This man with lime and rough cast doth present wall. That vile rock doth get these lovers sunder, and through wall's chink, poor souls they are content to whisper, at the which let no man wonder. This man with lanthorn dog and bush of thorn presented moonshine, for if you will know, by moonshine do these lovers think no scorn to meet at Nina's tomb. There to woo. This grisly beast which lion hights by name, the trusty Thisbe coming first by night, did scare away, or rather did affright, and as she fled, her mantle she did fall, which lion vile with bloody mouth did stain. Anon comes Pyramus, sweet youth and tall, and finds his trusty Thisbe's mantle slain. Whereat, with blade, with bloody, blameful blade, he bravely broached his boiling, bloody breast, and Thisbe, tarrying in mulberry shade, his dagger drew and died. For all the rest, let lion, moonshine, wall, and lovers twain at large discourse, while here they do remain.
I wonder what the lion means.
No wonder, my lord. One lion may, when many asses do.
In this same interlude, it thus befall that I, when snout by name present, a wall. It's such a wall that I would have you think that had in it a cranny, hole, or chink, which the lovers, Pyramus and Thisbe, did often whisper very secretly. This low, this rough cast, and this stone doth show that I am that same wall. The truth is so, and this the cranny is, right and sinister, through which the fearful lovers are to whisper.
You desired lime and hair to speak it better?
It is the wittiest partition that e'er I heard discourse, my lord.
Pyramus draws near the wall. Silence.
Oh, grim look, night! Oh, night with you so black! Oh, night, whichever art when day is not. Oh, night. Oh, night.
Lime?
Alack, alack, alack. I fear my Thisbe's promise is forgot. And now, oh, wall. Oh, sweet, oh, lovely wall. That stands between her father's ground and mine. That wall. Oh, wall. Oh, sweet, oh, lovely wall. Lend me thy cheek to blink through with mine eye. Thanks, courteous wall. Jove shield thee well for this. But what see I? No Thisbe do I see. Oh, wicked wall through whom I see no bliss. Cursed be thy stone thus deceive me.
The wall methinks being sensible should curse again.
No, true, sir, he should not. Deceiving is Thisbe's cue to enter. She will enter now, and I will spy her through the wall. All shall fall pat as I told you. Shh, 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 honest
Oh, wall! How often hast thou heard
my fair Pyramus and me. My lips have often kissed thy stones. Thy stones with lime and hair knit up with thee.
I see a voice. Now will I to the wall to spy, and I can hear my Thisbe's face.
Thisbe! My love? Thou art my love, I think.
Thee with thy wilt, I am thy lover's grace, and like Lamander in my trusty stead.
And I like Helen to the face me kill.
Not Schaffelus to Procris was so true.
As Schaffelus to Procris, I to you.
Oh, kiss me through the hole of this vile wall!
I kiss the wall's hole! Not your lips at all!
Wilt thou at Ninny's tomb meet me straightway?
Ninus
tomb.
Tie life! Tie death! I come without the land!
Oh, good job, good job!
Thus have I, wall, my part discharged so, and, being done, thus wall, away doth go.
Two noble beasts in, a man and a lion.
You, ladies, you, whose gentle hearts do fear the smallest monstrous mouse that creeps on the floor, may now perchance both quake and tremble here when lion and wildest rage doth roar! Roar! Then know that I, once snug the joiner, am a lion fell, nor else no lion's dam. For if I as lion should come into this place and strife, it were a pity on my life.
Very courageous beast, of a good conscience.
The very best at a beast, my lord, that e'er I saw.
Let us listen to the moon.
This lantern doth the horned moon present.
He should have worn the horns on his head.
He has no crescent, and his horns are visible within his circumference.
This lantern doth the horned moon present. Myself, the man of the moon, you see.
No. This is the greatest of all the rest. The man should be put into the lantern. How is it else the man in the moon?
He dares not come there for the candle, for you see, it is already in snuff.
I am very weary of this moon. What he would change?
It appears by his small light of discretion that he is in the wane. Yet, in courtesy, in all reason, we must stay the time.
Proceed, moon. All that I have to tell you is that this lanthorn is the moon. Myself, the man in the moon. This thornbush, my thornbush, and this dog.
My dog.
Why, all this should be put in the lanthorn, for all these are in the moon. But silence.
This is old Ninny's tomb.
Ninus
tomb. Where is my love?
Well roared, lion.
Well run, Thisbe.
Well shown, moon. Truly the moon shines with good grace.
Roar! Roar! Roar!
No mouse lion.
And so the lion vanished.
And then came Pyramus.
Sweet moon, I thank thee for thy sunny beams. I thank thee, moon, for shining now so bright.
By thy gracious gold and glittering gleams, I trust to take of truest Thisbe's sight. But stay, O spite! But mark, poor knight, what dreadful dole is here. Eyes, do you see? How can it be? Oh, dainty duck, oh dear, thy mantle good. What, stained with blood? Approach ye, fiery spell, oh fates, come, come, cut thread and thrum, quail, crush, conclude, and quell.
This passion, dear friend, may do to make a man look sad.
It's true, my heart, but I pity the man.
Oh, wherefore, nature, didst thou lion's frame, since lion vile hath here deflowered, my dear?
Devoured!
Devoured, my dear! Which is? No, no, which was the fairest dame that ever lived, that loved, that liked, that looked with cheer? Come, tears, confound. Out, sword, and wound the pap of Pyramus. Aye, that left pap where heart doth hop. Thus die I. Ah! Oh! Oh! Thus! Ah! Oh! Oh! Thus! Thus! Now am I dead! Now am I fled! My soul is in the sky! Tongue, lose thy light! Moon, take thy flight! And die! 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 Die.
For him, for he is but one.
Less than an ace, man, for he is dead. He is nothing.
With the help of the surgeon, he might yet recover and prove an ass.
How chance Thisbe comes back and finds your lover dead?
Oh, she'll find him by starlight. Oh, here she comes, and her passion ends the play.
She had spied him already with those sweet eyes.
Asleep, my love? What, dead, my dove? Oh, here, Miss Rise. Speak! Speak! Quite gone? Dead?
Dead!
A tomb must cover thy sweet eyes. These, my lips, this cherry nose, these yellow cowslip cheeks,
are gone. Are gone.
Lovers make moan. His eyes were green as hers.
Oh, sisters three, come, come to me. With hands as pale as milk, lay them in gore, for which you have shore, with shears as thread of silk. Tongues, not a word. Come, trusty sword. Come, blade, to my breast and room. And farewell, friends. Thus Thisbe ends. Adieu. Ah. Adieu. Ah. Adieu. Oh.
Moonshine and Lion are left to bury the dead.
Aye, and Wall too.
No, sir, I assure you, the wall is down part of their fathers. Will it please you to see an epilogue or a bergamot stamp between two of our company?
No epilogue, I pray you, for your play needs no excuse. Never excuse. For when the players are all dead, there needs none to be blamed. With it, if he who writ it played Pyramus and hanged himself in Thisbe's garter, it would have been a fine tragedy. And so it is, truly, very notably, discharged.
Yes!
Let's your epilogue alone. Sleep the coming morn, as much as we this night hath overwatched. This palpable gross play hath well beguiled the left heavy gate of night. Sweet friends, to bed. A fortnight hold we this solemnity, and nightly revels in new jollity.
Visions did appear, and this weak and idle theme, no more yielding, but a dream. Gentles, do not reprehend. If you pardon, we will mend. And as I am an honest fuck, if we have a nerded luck that should escape the serpent's tongue, we will make amends ere long. Else the puck, a liar call. So good night unto you all. Give me your hands if we be friends, and Robin shall restore amends. Woo!